And just like that, we have arrived at the heart of linear algebra, the concept of linear independence. Linear independence is so important that just about every future video will rely on it, and every subsequent topic in linear algebra will be directly or indirectly built upon the concept of linear independence. So before I give you a formal definition, let me motivate it with an example. I will give you a decomposition example, not unlike many that we've considered so far, but there will be something very different about this one. So once again, it involves geometric vectors, because we always start with geometric vectors when we arrive at a new concept. It's our key to intuition and visualization. So given three vectors, A, B, and C, we need to decompose the vector D as a linear combination of A, B, and C. And maybe you can almost right away see what makes this example so different from all the ones we've considered until now. And it's the fact that there are more than one answer. There's more than one way of doing it. So in anticipation of that, I will write down two more templates. And while I'm doing it, why don't you think of several ways of decomposing the vector D as a linear combination of vectors A and B. And we'll see if I come up with them in the same order as you thought of them. Okay, so let me try and guess the first one you thought of. I think it's best to take advantage of the right angle between A and B. I'm thinking of both A and B as being unit length. C is at a 45 degree angle to both of them and has length square root 2. So that perfect arrangement. So D, taking advantage of this right angle, I think can be seen as 2A plus B. I'll bet you most of you thought of that linear combination first. So let's write it in. 2A plus 1B and none of C. Okay, that's one. And another one you can see from the parallelogram rule involving A and C is just A plus C and none of B. So one of A, zero of B, and one C, A plus C. Can you see one more? So let me show you the one that I see most easily. It won't fit in the shot, but if we take 2C and come down to D with minus B, that's another way to get D, as 2C minus B. So none of A minus one of B and 2C. And you can probably guess, or you're beginning to see, that there are probably infinitely many ways of doing this. So why? Why is it that before there was only one way to find decomposition, or maybe none, and now there are perhaps infinitely many? What is it about the vectors A, B, and C that causes this? Can you put it in words or as a mathematical expression? Well, let me give you the reason as I see it. The reason is that there is a relationship between A, B, and C. They're not independent. One can be expressed as a linear combination of the other two. That's the relationship among them. And that relationship is C equals A plus B. C equals A plus B. C equals A plus B. There is a relationship among A, B, and C. So that means that whenever we're looking at a linear combination that produces a vector D, whenever there is, in one way or another, A plus B in there, we can take it out and replace it with C. That's actually what happened from the first linear combination to the second. There were 2A, we went down to 1A, we took out a B, and instead we added C. And that was possible. In other words, it produced the same result because of this relationship between A, B, and C. And that's actually precisely what we did in the next step. We took out another A, we took out another B, and we made up for it with another C, because C effectively replaces A plus B. And now that we've noticed this, we can easily come up with infinitely many linear combinations that will produce D. Let's just do it one more time. Take out one A, one B, and make up for it with another C. So minus A minus 2B plus 3C is most definitely, will once again be D. I just can't resist making one important side comment right now. It's one that I've made several times in the past videos, and one that I will probably make many more times in the future videos. I think we're observing a wonderful interplay here between algebra and geometry that's so central to the mindset of linear algebra as I see it. Just 2 minutes ago, we came up with these three linear combinations geometrically. We looked at the picture, we judged the relative arrangement of the vectors A, B, and C, and rather easily we came up with these three linear combinations. But a fourth and a fifth would have proven challenging. But then we observed a special relationship between the vectors A, B, and C. We expressed that algebraically. And once that happened, we came up not with four or five, but immediately with infinitely many linear combinations that yield the vector D. So the moral of the story is that geometry is beautiful and powerful in its own right, but limited. And algebra is powerful in its own right, but with algebra alone, we would not have been able to come up with even one linear combination of A, B, and C that yields D, because D is not in this relationship. But once algebra yields its helping hand to geometry, the result is incredible. So these two subjects are powerful on their own, but it's their combination that's so much more powerful than the sum of the parts. All right, now I'm ready to leave you with a formal definition of linear independence and linear dependence. A set of vectors, in this case we have three, but this definition applies to any number of vectors. A set of vectors is linearly dependent if one of the vectors can be expressed as a linear combination of the rest. The set of vectors A, B, and C is linearly dependent because C can be expressed as a linear combination of A and B. Now, of course, A can be expressed as a linear combination of B and C, and B can be expressed as a linear combination of A and C. So any one of those relationships would have qualified this set as linearly dependent, but you only need one. A set of vectors is linearly dependent if one of the vectors can be expressed as a linear combination of the rest. Now, linear independence is opposite of linear dependence. A set of vectors is linearly independent if no one of the vectors can be expressed as a linear combination of the rest. Once again, a set of vectors is linearly independent if none of the vectors can be expressed as a linear combination of the rest. All right, in the next video, we will up the ante and we'll task ourselves with capturing all possible linear combinations of A, B, and C that produce D. We'll try to do so as a mathematical expression, and that will lead us to an alternative definition of linear dependence and linear independence.